This is a second part of a beginner Blender Python tutorial where we're going over the code that creates a rolling cube animation. In this video, we're going to be cleaning up the code by splitting the code into functions. Hey, I'm Victor Stepanoff. I'll be guiding you through this beginner Blender Python tutorial. Today, we're going to be continuing to work on the code that we created in the previous video. This code creates a rolling cube animation as you see on your screen. We're going to be transforming this wall of code into separate functions. If you don't have this code handy, don't worry. I've provided a link in the description under Start Code. Open that link in your favorite browser, hit Raw, select all the code and copy it. Go back into Blender and open the scripting workspace, hit New and paste in that code. Also, right under the 3D viewport, let's open a timeline so we can see frames. And let's clear the scene by hitting AX and then delete and then running this code. You should get something like this. And if you've seen my other tutorials where I split up the code into functions, I challenge you to take this code and try to split it up on your own. This will help you solidify the knowledge of splitting up code into functions. You could pause the video and come back when you're done. Don't worry if you can only split up this code into a single function. One function is better than none. All right, let's get going. The very first thing that I want to do is I want to create a main function. I'm just going to take this code right here by selecting it and holding Shift and then hitting Tab to indent it. Place it under a function and add the main function. So I'm using def to define a function, creating the name, and this main function won't have any parameters. And now if I clear the scene by hitting AX and then delete, and then running the script, nothing will happen because this script only is defining a function at this point. It's not actually running this function. So now after we've defined the function, let's go to the very bottom of the script and actually execute it. So now if I run this script, you can see that we're generating the animation. Next, let's move the code for creating the cube into a separate function. So I'm just going to go ahead and copy or cut this code right here. Go up here and create a new function. So I've named this function createCube. I will also be returning the cube from this function. Cut that and write return. Then at the call side, I'm going to call the function and return whatever the active object is, which is the cube, as soon as we add it. I'll also update the doc string right here so people would know what this is. And now let's clear the scene and rerun our script. And you can see we can still generate this animation. It's very important to continue to run your script as you're moving code into functions. This way you can make sure that you didn't make a mistake and then go back scratching your head what exactly is wrong and where you made the mistake. Okay, now let's create the same function for creating empties. I'm going to cut this code right here and go right here and create a new function for creating empties. I'm going to be returning the empty variable from this function. Also, I'll be passing in the location. I'll replace the location parameter with this right here. And now we can go ahead and copy call right here. So instead of locations, it's just going to be that. And since we're returning the empty, I'm going to assign the returning empty into a variable called empty. Now let's clear the scene, run the script, and this still works. Awesome. Next, let's move the parenting code right here. I'm going to remove this old code that we don't need anymore. Again, if you chose this code from the previous video, we can move this code as well. I'm just going to go ahead and cut the code from here and create a new function up here. I decided to name the function called parent. And also, I'm planning to make it this function a bit more general so we can reuse it in other situations. So instead of passing in the empty or naming the parameter as an empty, I'm just going to call it a child object and the parent object. Also, I'll be able to control if I want to keep the transform or when I'm parenting that object. So this is going to be the child empty, and the parent is going to be the previous empty. And now let's create an if statement right here. And if we do want to keep the transform only, then we're going to be running this inverse operation. And now let's go back to where we got that code from. So it's here. So we got the empty, got the previous empty, and we do want to keep the transform. All right, that looks good. Let's clear the scene, run it, and okay, our code is still working. Also, I want to go up here and update the documentation string like so, so we can see what this function is doing. Now let's move the code that is adding the keyframe. So this code right here, and let's put that into a separate function and call it animate rotation. So it's going to look like this. And this one's a bit tricky since we're not only we need to pass in the current frame, but we're also updating the current frame. So that means that we need to return the current frame from this function as well. So we need to pass it in and return it. Again, we're just passing in the object. So these are going to be the objects. It doesn't really have to be empty, making it more general. Current frame is left as is. The rotation angle, again, we're using it right here. And the rotation animation length, it's the frame, the number of frames that the rotation is going to be occurring at, and we're using it right here. Let's also update this documentation string. And now let's call this function where we cut that code from. So it's in this for loop. And remember, we're returning the current frame, so we can use it on the next iteration of this for loop. I'll write that. Yeah, I need to update object. Okay, that looks good. Let's clear the scene and rerun our script. And okay, our animation generation is still working. Now we're ready to extract this code right here. So this is going to be the two for loops that are animating the revolutions of the cube. So I'm going to cut this code and go up here, paste that in, and create a new function called animate revolutions. The parameters that we need for this function is the number of revolutions, the empty locations, the rotation angle, and the rotation animation length. So that goes right here. We'll also need to pull in a couple of variables that we have here. For example, the current frame, I think we can move it into this function. I think we can also move this variable as well. And also I'm going to create another variable here just to be nice and clean that we're defining a function, a variable. For example, here we were just starting to use it and assigning this variable right here, but I want to make sure that it's initialized at least to something by doing this. And I'll also add the comments to make sure to understand like what this is. So, like so, and actually, you know what, I'll move this for that, so it's like previous empty and then root empty, so that makes more sense. Let's add a doc string right here, like so. And there's one catch to this particular function. When we're going to be calling it right here, so that is this empty locations, rotation angle, and the rotation animation length. So that's good. But we actually need to return two things from this function. So we need to return the previous empty and actually the root empty. So that right there. And to do that, we can actually return two things, not only one, from a function. So it's going to look like this, like so. So you can return another thing by using a comma. And then on the receiving end, just write this, and both of those returning values will be mapped to these two variables. And now we can use the root empty right here and the previous empty right here. I'm gonna comment this out for a second so I don't have the cube animation jumping somewhere else, so we can see it update. So I'm gonna delete this, and I think this should work. And yes, okay. Yeah, the code is still working. That is great. And let's see what we can do next. Next, I think we can add another variable right here that's going to be the starting position. So we can use that right here when we're assigning the location of the roll animation. Here's the variable, and I've also left a comment for whoever is going to be reading this in the future. And we can just assign the location like so. So instead of just using one of the X, Y, and Z properties, I'm going to assign all the X, Y, and Z properties at the same time by using this tuple right here. And now if we clear the scene and run our script, I see now we can set the start location of this rolling animation. We can continue to split this up even more by selecting this code here and creating another function up here that's going to be named roll cube, like so. We can move the empty locations into this function. We can also move the rotation animation length. Now we would need to pass in the cube itself, the number of revolutions, and the starting position. So that's going to be all right here. So now we have a nice clean main function that is creating the cube, setting the number of revolutions, and the starting position of the cube roll animation. And let's make sure that this still works. Clear the scene, run the script. And this still works. Great. And let's don't forget to create the documentation string for our roll cube function, like so. And if you're learning something new and enjoying this tutorial, make sure to hit the like button so I can understand to make more videos like this. For the final touch, I want to make sure that we can update the length of the animation. As you can see, the animation still continues to go even after the cube has stopped rolling. And to do that, I'm just going to update this by hand and copy the code from the info panel down below. And I'm going to just put that code right here. Just copy that or paste that. I'm going to select the current frame and paste that in and make sure to add a comment like so. And let's see, after I've updated this, after I run the script again, I'm going to set this back to 250 as it was before. I'm going to clear the scene, and now after I run the script, this should update to the correct length of the animation. And as you can see, it did just that. And now as I play the animation, it's going to quickly loop back to the very beginning of the animation. All right. I'll be posting a link to this final code in the description, so make sure to check that out. If you updated the script in a different way, make sure to share that in the comments, or maybe have some questions about why I created a particular function. Make sure to ask them down below. For more tutorials like this, make sure to subscribe, and thank you so much for watching.